only one danced before the Lord, David. And it says that he was the apple of God's eye. So ladies, you are the apple of God's eye this morning. Amen? Listen, that takes a lot of bravery, a lot of courage. It's not easy. You don't see any of us up here dancing. Although I keep asking them to do the running man and they don't. But thank you, ladies. That was awesome. Really did. And then worship team. You guys, you know, this morning, I don't know about you, but this morning, like, I wasn't thinking about anything but God. Yes. And then that last song, I was just thanking him. It's like they just removed everything from my mind other than God. So worship team, outstanding job this morning. You guys absolutely did a great job. Yeah. Amen, amen. Well, if you're like me, I'm a little disappointed because the Olympics are over. I love watching the Olympics, and so I'm back to watching some of the politics. And so this week I was watching, you know, some of the news stations or whatever, and one of the correspondents made the comment, which I found pretty interesting, and said that, you know, essentially both of the candidates, their campaign was to find fault in each other. That's the campaign they're running. You know, and I had to think about that for a second, because really when you look at that, again, you know, let's put it in practical terms. They're both looking and applying for a job. Has anybody ever applied for a job? I mean, it may have been a while. For me, it's been a while since I've, you know, gone for an interview, but I do interview folks in my line of work. And, you know, I thought about that. It's like, when I interviewed for the job, I want to tell the folks why I feel I'm competent and able to perform that job. And likewise, when I'm interviewing people, I want to know that you can do the job. Like, if someone came in and said, hey, the guy in the waiting room, he's a clown, he's no good, he definitely ain't going to be able to do the job, you know, this, that, okay, well, great, but what does that tell me about, can you do the job that I want you to do? I don't know if you can or not. And that's essentially what, you know, the campaign and the presidents are doing. Hopefully, you should find comfort or solace in the fact that one of them, based on their campaign, you say, oh, yeah, I think this individual can do the job, and here's why. But, I mean, when you're just, you know, telling each other's faults, I don't know if either one of you are competent to actually do the job just because you're telling me why this one can't. And so, you know, obviously that, you know, is not what it's about. And, you know, even I thought about kind of, you know, the insurance in this country. It's going through the roof. And Florida happens to be what? A no-fault state. And what does that mean, no-fault state? It means really that simple. If you get into an accident, your insurance covers your stuff, and his insurance or her insurance covers their stuff. And when that was basically put in place, there's about 20-something states in the country that have a no-fault policy, which basically means your insurance premiums should come down because there's not litigation. Because in some of the states where you don't embrace that, they litigate. They find who's at fault for the accident, and then the other person, what? They have to pay more, which means your insurance premiums are higher. So Florida, we are all blessed to live in the no-fault state. Hopefully everybody enjoys lower insurance rates. And so likewise, there is no fault. They basically now, listen, the roads are crowded, stuff happens, there's gonna be accidents. There's really nobody's fault. I mean, think about it, there really isn't. I mean, if you think about, especially here in Florida, the roads are just getting, accidents are gonna happen. But sometimes, you know, it's just human nature. We like to say, even in Florida, you still want to find out whose fault it was. You know, folks will still call the cops. The cops will come. Yeah, it was his fault or it was her fault. It doesn't matter. It's a no-fault state, folks. Just go make your claims and get your car fixed and go about your business, right? But we want justice. And so we try and find the justice in applying the fault. And of course, you know, so we're clear, the kingdom of heaven is a no-fault state. Is it not? I mean, do you think God's going to say, okay, welcome into the kingdom, now let's see who's at fault here? No, it'll be ridiculous, of course. He runs it the same way that Florida runs their insurance. It's a no-fault kingdom. It's no fault. And I believe, you know, if we start to see things different and understand things different, we won't find fault. Even as my brother preached last week, you know, he said to repent or perish, and repent is to change the way you see life and change how you look at things. And I pray we may have applied some of that this week. I did. David said that I considered my thoughts. Why did he consider his thoughts? Because he thought before he spoke. That's why he considered his thoughts. Let me see how I'm going to respond in this situation. He considered his thoughts, and that's what I did this week. I found myself in a couple of situations that I didn't particularly quite understand, or maybe I didn't really like them initially, but I thought about my brother's message, and I thought about thinking differently before I responded and before I reacted, so that I would not likewise perish. And I can say, in those instances, I believe I responded just as God would have expected me to, because I considered my thoughts. And I believe if we consider our thoughts, we will find less fault. And really, if you, even when you do that, like, have you, we've all probably done it, you don't have to raise your hands, I have. There's many times I have found Mike to be at fault. It's understandable. He's a faulty kind of guy. But it never, when those situations rise up and we do that, like, I don't feel better just because I found fault in somebody else. It never fixes, like, even in the accidents. If you find someone, your car's still wrecked. I mean, you still gotta go get it. Like, it doesn't, that application itself in finding the fault doesn't fix anything. You don't feel better and it doesn't correct anything. So really, the act of finding fault itself is actually worthless. It's pointless. It does nothing for you, naturally and certainly spiritually. Because again, we are talking obviously spiritually here in the context of how God would have us to see life. And I believe God wants us to live a life where we're not looking to find fault. Because it's similar to last week's message, when you find the fault, you will be the one that perishes. So you do have to see things differently and live a life differently, because the kingdom of God is without fault. You say, where's the scripture to prove that? There's thousands of them. Go find them. The kingdom of God is without fault. Amen? I'd like to take a look at actually Mark chapter 7. And it's a fairly familiar passage that I believe will, you know, essentially, hopefully, open our eyes to see exactly what God is, you know, expecting from us. And how do we live this life? And how do we live in this kingdom where we don't find fault, and we truly understand that there's a God, and that he loves us, and that he truly wants us to live this life in peace and in unity, and not causing these divisions and separations. Amen? So chapter 7, verse 1. Then came together unto him the Pharisees and certain of the scribes, which came from Jerusalem. And when they saw, verse 2, and when they saw some of his disciples eat bread with defiled, that is to say, with unwashing hands, they found fault. They found fault. And the word fault is only mentioned a few times in the Bible, but this happens to be one of them. So here we have some folks. It looks like they were in Jerusalem, so scribes and Pharisees, they likely were probably at church. They left, and they what? They went to go find Jesus and his disciples. Now, right there, you got to ask yourself, why were they searching these men out? What were their intentions? Was it to say, hey, we want to spend some time with you and enjoy the day? Or did they have something else in mind, perhaps? I believe, based on verse 2, they had some other things in mind. And it says what? They saw some disciples. They saw. You see, you got to, we see things first, and then we generally react. So I believe they were looking for trouble. Listen, when you look for trouble, here's what I usually find when, growing up, you know, especially with my two brothers, when we were looking for trouble, we were pretty good at it. We found it. And boy, did we find plenty of it. And that's what I see in this verse. You know, it's the same thing in the garden. Lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. They saw. Didn't Eve see? She saw. And then what? Well, it's what I want. And then what? Well, because it's going to make me wise. Because that means I am better than you. Self-exaltation. But they said they saw. And then what happens? Well, they're seeing them eating, but it says that they didn't wash their hands. And so, of course, I see the hands always as significant of the works. Their works. Their works were not clean. They didn't, because after all, they would wash their hands. Now, they didn't have to wash their hands before the meal. Now, they're taking and applying the priest before they would go into the tabernacle. In Moses' days, they would actually wash their hands before they went to the temple. They didn't wash them before they ate. So it was talking about being ceremonially clean, which the works never will, right? Didn't Paul say that? You know, shall Shall the foot say to this hand, hey, ain't I part of the body? And the ear to the eye, hey, ain't I part of the body? And the truth of the matter is, yes, the foot is part of the body, and so is the hands. But the foot is talking about the lifestyle. The hand is talking about the works. So which comes first? Is it my lifestyle or is it the works? Well, in this case, the scribes and the Pharisees, it was their works. It was their rituals. It was the things that they followed that they felt made them holy or made them better than them. It was basically the campaign. Here's why we're better. They got dirty hands. How is that any different today? I believe it's the same thing. To point out something else, but it's not about the works, it's not about the rituals. And the truth is sometimes, I've been guilty of that as well. I think my rituals, the things that I follow to serve God, are the most important thing in life. And so if I see somebody not following and doing things my way, I say, you've got dirty hands. I say, you don't deserve to eat. But again, that's ritual. That's not God, that's ritual. It's just things that we've learned over time, and that's essentially what these scribes and Pharisees had done. And it says what? They found fault. They presumed to know better. They thought they had something better, and so, again, they were exalting themselves, and so the others were not. They didn't deserve it. And that's the presumptuous sin. David also prayed that prayer. He said, Lord, forgive me of my presumptuous sin. Forgive me, Lord, for assuming I know better than you. That's essentially what that prayer was. Because sometimes we think we know better than God, right? No? Just the preacher? Yeah, sometimes we do that. And the truth is, you can't. You can't possibly know better than God. And again, it's not about the works, church. It's about the lifestyle. Remember when Jesus, he washed the disciples' feet? And what did Peter say? Lord, no, you can't wash my feet. He said, Peter, if I don't do this, you can't follow me. I don't know who you're going to follow, but it ain't me. And once again, we're talking about the lifestyle, the life that's lived. And what is the life that's lived? It's a life of faith, church. Because he said, listen, you're already clean. He told Peter, you're already clean. Because remember, Peter said, well, then wash me and everything. You're already clean, church. So how does the rest of the world know we follow him? My lifestyle, my walk. I walk by faith. I live by faith and faith alone. I don't look at what everybody else does to determine my acceptance between God or my acceptance between man. That's the ritual. I say, what does God want me to do? How does God want me to live? God wants me to live by faith. And unless we let him wash our feet, we cannot follow him. You will not live like Jesus Christ. You will not live a life of faith. So it's not about my works. Nothing you can do makes you any holier than you are right now. What makes you holy is the Spirit of Christ that dwells inside of you right now, period. And then that Spirit enables you to walk like him. Yes, I need my hands, but I need my feet too so I can walk it out. And then what'll I do? Well, then I'll love my neighbor. Then I'll forgive my neighbor. The hands don't determine whether I'm good. It's my feet. It's my lifestyle. You are clean. He even said that. These are the very words of Christ. But they found the fault. This is no different than when the Israelites, when they didn't go into the promised land. We talked about that a couple of weeks ago, remember? And then they were like, okay, now what are we going to do? And so, you know, they blamed Moses. And they were getting ready to cast stones at him. They said, we're going to get ourselves a new captain and go back to Egypt. Remember that account? What does Moses do? Moses says, hey, wait a second here, man. God's still going to keep his promise. And then he says, he gets before the Lord. He gets upon his face and says, Lord, what about my people? What about your people, Lord? And he says, well, listen, Moses. They're just not listening. He said, no, wait a second, Lord. You're long-suffering. You're kind. You're merciful. All right, Moses. All right. We'll get him into the promised land. We'll get him into the promised land. But only those 20 and younger. Because those 20 and up, we're going to spend what? Well, the next 40 years in the wilderness. 40 plus 60, it's 20. It's 40 and 20 is 60. It's just man. Until I get the man out of you, the selfish nature out of you, you ain't going to get into the promised land. You see, the fact was, Moses forgave them, really, in that situation. Now, God forgives all the time. But Moses forgave before God forgave, because they wanted to kill him and wanted to pick a new leader. Moses didn't hold that against him. He still got before the Lord. He fell down on his face and said, Lord, please, not my people. He didn't even let go of them. He still said, my people. Even though they rejected him and wanted to kill him, he said, Lord, my people. He forgave them. He forgave them. And then likewise, God, of course, because of the prayers of the righteous man availed much. He saw that there was forgiveness, of course. God forgave him, forgave the people, and said, yes, okay. And then it was real simple. He said, now listen, he said, unfortunately, though, you got to now leave where you are and go wander in the wilderness for 40 years. Moses says, okay. He relays the message to the people. And what do the people do? Nah, I think we're going to stay right here. It said they presumed to know better. And then they went up the hill and they were going to take the mountain where the Amalekites and the Canaanites were. And it said that the ark of the Lord was with them. God was with them. Now, he told them to go the other way. Did he not? They presumed to know better. Better than who? God. They go up the mountain. What happens? They get destroyed. You see, it's not like our disobedience and then God's going to honor the disobedience. Well, you're my people. I got to protect you. No. I mean, I'm with you, but you don't listen. And the Amalekites, the Canaanites, it's just selfishness. And then the Canaanites, it brings on sorrow and depression and all of that. My selfish behavior will always bring upon that. It may not be immediate. It may take a little bit of time. But what I have found, my selfish behavior generally brings on sorrow. They presume to know better than God. Isn't that insane when you think about it? Of course we think that's insane sitting here in church, but Monday I'm going to presume I know better and do something, I'm sure. Just the pastor, you guys are all smooth and just cruising through life with no problems. We do. God is with us, even in our silliness, even in our foolishness. God is still with us. But he's still saying, listen, I mean, who shall disannul my word? Who's going to make my word void, worthless, pointless? Nobody. No one. Amen. No one. You still got to do what he says. You still got to follow. Now, again, the plan is still, like we talked about, it's the promised land. But it's not based on how I see it playing out or how I think it's supposed to play out. It's based on God. Faith. Just listen. You can't know better than God. It's impossible to know better than God. They presume to know better, so they find the fault. Verse 3. For the Pharisees and all the Jews, except they wash their hands oft, eat not, holding the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the market, except they wash, they eat not. And many other things they be, which they have received to hold, as the washing of cups, pots, brassen vessels, and tables. And the Pharisees and the scribes ask him, why walk not thy disciples according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands? Why are your men not doing things the way we do things, and why are they following you, Jesus Christ, Son of the living God? Can you imagine, like, making that accusation to Jesus Christ, like, in the flesh? Why are your guys not doing what we do? Why are they doing what you tell them to do? And sometimes that's what church does. Church follows traditions versus the word of God. You want a real popular tradition? How about an altar call? Anybody ever go to a church service where there was an altar call? You want Jesus Christ? You got to come up to this altar. I'm going to say this prayer, and then you're going to go talk to some of our counselors in the closet back here. I'm going to work you over real good. Listen, I've done that. I have done that. Not I have prayed that prayer. I have also led others in that prayer. The problem? It's a tradition. I can't find it in here anywhere. Is there something wrong with it? No, there's nothing wrong with it. What's wrong with it is the minute I say, if you don't do that, you don't have Jesus Christ. The minute I do that and say, the Spirit of God doesn't dwell in you. Why? Well, you didn't invite him into your heart. The last time I checked, he called you by name. He came and grabbed you out of your Sea of Galilee and said, come follow me. That's a tradition, church. Now, how many churches do that? Gazillions. How many altar calls will be given today? They can't count them. Now, let me ask you something. Before they come up to the altar, is the Spirit of God in them? Okay. Now, the prayer is okay. Hopefully, it ignites some kind of fire and acknowledges something or whatever, and that's okay. But the Spirit of God is in them, whether they say that prayer or not. It's a tradition. It's not the Word of God, and it's not what He's called us to do. There's nothing wrong if they say that prayer. There's nothing wrong if they do that. But again, it's a tradition. And so when I ignore God's word over the tradition, I say, listen, you're on the wrong road. And I'm likely, again, then I'm going to find the gaps. It's not about finding the gaps. Why the traditions? Why can't we just follow the word of God? It's so simple. It's so easy. And listen, there's hundreds like that, but that's just like the classic of all time, the altar call. In case you haven't noticed, my brother and I don't do an altar call. We've actually not been considered a traditional church. Newsflash. Shocking. We're like, oh, really? We weren't notified of this, Mike. Who cares? I don't want tradition. Now, if it's the Word of God, you know we're going to apply the Word of God, and we're going to preach the Word of God, and we're going to follow the Word of God. We don't ignore the word of God. We cherish it. But I'm willing to let go of some traditions. Listen, I had plenty of them growing up, and it's okay. God shows us in that. But then you got to let go of the traditions, man. He even said that in Hebrew. He said, listen, the first one, it had fault. If it had been faultless, I wouldn't brought the second covenant. The covenant's called grace. Romans also says, you ain't under the law anymore. You're under grace. Quit making the altar call. You're under grace, man. But we apply the law and we find the fault. And when I see that you don't follow it, I got to see it though. And sometimes it's the silliest things, right? Because we'll define a person's life based on one instance that sometimes literally could be a 30-second instance, define their whole life. Ryan Lochte. The entire world is defining this man's life because he made a foolish decision in a silly situation. And I think it was fear, it was all kinds of stuff, you know, it was just silliness. So now he is absolutely worthless, sponsors are dropping him, he's rotten, he's no good for the country. Give us back your medals. Yeah, you applauding him when he was winning gold back in them days. What, the Spirit of Christ in him doesn't deserve a second chance? The Spirit of Christ in him can't work in his life and change his life and make him better and stronger and faster? Can't he be the $6 million man? Da-na-na-na. You young kids don't remember that one growing up, but we had to watch it. It was like my dad's favorite show, The $6 Million Man. Yeah, we get better, we get stronger, we get faster. Why? By the power of Christ. But we hold on to these silly traditions and we say, going to follow them instead of Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, my King. And then we wonder why we wind up in all these situations with the Amalekites and the Canaanites defeating us. Well, because you didn't do what I said in the first place. You didn't have to do that. You would have went the other way. Ain't nobody going to touch you. But we didn't listen. He answered and said unto them, well, hath Isaiah prophesied of you, hypocrites, as it is written, the people honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men, as washing pots and cups, and many other such things like these you do. There's like a lot more stuff like we do in traditions other than just washing the pots and the pans and everything else. They're called altar calls, they're called communion, they're called christen the baby, they're called say our Father six times a day. How many times Hail Mary, Dad? Is that a lot, too many the county says? Okay. Yeah, I can't find it in scripture anywhere, but the traditions of men would say if you don't do that, you're not holy. If you don't do that, you don't love God. If you don't do that, you ain't going to heaven. If. And you just turn God into a conditional God. He said, I loved you while you were yet sinners, and I died for you. I wasn't looking you to get fixed up and cleaned up and holied up. I just came because I loved you. I want you to know how great you are. I want you to know how pure you are. I want you to know how holy you are. You got no hand in this thing. I know what I created. I'm trying to pull it out of you. And I believe that's exactly what he is doing. I believe he is drawing it out of us. And it's not the hands, it's not the works. There's nothing you can do. And then when I do that, yes, I do things. Why? Because of my heart, my passion, my conviction. That's what compels me to go the extra mile. God compels me to go the extra mile. The law says only go 1 mile. I say, no problem. I'll carry your stuff 2 miles. I don't need the law. I got something far greater than the law. It's called grace. Grace that'll go past any boundaries. Grace that'll enable me to see a much bigger life. One where I don't find fault. Because I know the second covenant. I know he came. I know it's powerful. I know it produces life. I ain't letting go of that. No, no, no. Number 9. And he said unto them, full well you reject the commandment of God. You know good and well you rejecting God's word. They knew it. It's not like they didn't know the law. It's not like they didn't know the word of God. No, they knew it. And they disregarded it anyway. We know God says, love thy neighbor, and I disregard it anyway. We know God says to forgive always, and I disregard it anyway. I know better. No, just the pastor again.
Amen.
We think we know better. You don't know better. You cannot make his word void. You cannot make his commandment void. Yeah, but he don't know what I saw. What? He knows all. He ain't looking at what you saw. He don't care about what you saw. Well, I don't like that. Well, tough. Get over it. How about we look at the heart? How about we look at Christ? How about somebody holds on to that? Full well you reject the commandment of God, that you may keep your own tradition. For Moses said, honor thy father and thy mother, and whoso curses his father or mother, let them die. He's now quoting Exodus. He's now quoting essentially the commandments that God gave them. Amen? But ye say, if a man shall say to his father or mother, it is Corban, that is to say, a gift by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, he shall be free. Born free as the wind. Yep, you can do whatever you want. It don't make it right. And what's he doing here? I love this. This word's only mentioned one time in the Bible. Here it is, Corban. He's actually quoting a word out of the Mishnah. He's actually quoting something out of the doctrines that they have written themselves. Not only can I quote the word of God, I tell you what, boys, I quote your silly words too. What you think it is. And that's essentially what the Mishnah was. The priests in those days, they would actually preach like we preach today. And then somebody would write down what they say. But then that would be law. They followed that, even if it was in conflict with this. As long as they did it for God. And that's what he's quoting, Corbin. Because Corbin would say, listen, if I do it for God, I don't have to love my mother and my father. I don't have to honor them. Because in those days, honor meant you took care of your family. And so God's going to imply something different other than for you to take care and treasure your family? Yeah, of course, you're going to honor and treasure your family. You're going to treat them the way they should be treated. You honor them. But you see, the Mishnah would say, hey, I can say Corbin. And you need help with the faucet today? I'm going to church, Dad. I'm doing the Lord's work. And I wouldn't honor my father. But as long as I said Corbin, I'm A-okay. You know what that is? Substitute. I'm calling in a substitution. Give me the left-handed pitcher. I'll bring somebody else to do that. Substitute. And they substitute God's word with their word. But hey, as long as they were doing it for the glory of Almighty God, I don't have to honor my mother and my father. I don't have to honor and treasure my family. No, nobody's doing that in this world today. Hey, if it's for the glory of God, hey, if they don't believe what I believe, if they don't come to my church, man, And you have families that will be divided, that will be split up. They won't even talk to each other over religion, over what I believe versus they believe. Well, they're not one of us. What do you mean they're not one of you? You bear the same name. And they say Corbin. So he's just playing it back to them, because what he's saying is, I know your heart, guys. I know your heart. You don't think I know what you're doing and that you're just trying to skirt around? You basically say something different in your Sunday services so you don't have to follow a certain commandment. Because once again, I know better than God. And sometimes, listen, they're not easy to follow. I get that. God gets that. But what are you supposed to do? Not persevere? Not walk it out? Not grow from it? Not be strengthened from it? Listen, he says you enter the kingdom through much tribulation. Anybody preaching that message? No, I just want to die and go to heaven. Hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Yeah, you can, but you're going to enter through much tribulation. There is a working out to this thing. He also says you got to work out your salvation with what? Fear and trembling. Work it out. This isn't hey, Jesus come into my heart, done, hallelujah. Peter said he's long-suffering, that none will perish, by the way. None will perish. Why is he long-suffering? Because he knows, church, it's going to take time. He knows you might make a few mistakes along the way and then learn from them and grow. That's why he's long-suffering. Amen. And he even says that in that verse, that he may do what? Bring about salvation. It's so that you will be saved. But he's long-suffering. He knows it takes time. You see, we don't have time. You do one thing, you wreck my car, done, out. I'm not long-suffering. You ain't going to wreck it twice. We say Corbin. This isn't God, church. And until we start looking at things differently and seeing these situations in our life differently, we'll cry Corbin. Because I don't have to, because this is how I feel in this given situation. So I don't have to follow God's word, because this is how I feel. I substitute it. Church, there is no substitution for God's word. Period. Amen. Period. It's just like David. Remember David when he was getting ready to, he knew he was getting ready to die, and he's getting ready to hand the mantle off to Solomon. And so he's giving him fatherly advice to run the kingdom. Makes sense to me. He says, okay, son, here. Let me tell you about some things that I learned along the way from God. You might want to keep them in mind. And then he gives him some very specific instruction. He says, Joab and Shimei, they better die with gray hair on their head. Joab and Shimei, they got to die with gray hair. Yeah, which means that they better get old. They better die an old death, which means what? It means you better protect them. If they die before their time, son, it's on you. You better protect them. They better go to their grave with gray hair on their head. And you say, who's Joab and who's Shimei? Great question. Well, Joab was family. Joab was Solomon's cousin. Imagine that. You mean he's supposed to protect his cousin? Yeah, he's supposed to treasure his cousin. He's supposed to honor his cousin. Now, the issue that I'm sure David saw, that he wanted to make sure his son also saw, was, listen, Joab also killed Solomon's brother, Absalom. That was Solomon's brother. Joab killed him. Thought he was doing it. He said, Corbin. Corbin! And he killed him. Even though David said not to. The Lord's in this. I know the Lord's in this. Because he wanted to overthrow his father. He ran him out of the kingdom. He ran him out. And so Joab, he did it in the name of the Lord. And I'm going to now kill him. Anybody ever kill anybody in the name of the Lord? Just Pastor Phil and Pastor Mike? We went on a killing spree. Yeah, we do, in the name of the Lord. But he's saying, hey, your cousin, you better protect him. You better not retaliate, and he better die with gray hair on his head. And then he says Shimei. Now, Shimei was the enemy, supposedly the enemy. Shimei was one of Saul's faithful servants. Shimei was also the one when Absalom ran him out of town. Shimei came along and was throwing rocks at him and said, you're a loser, you stink. You ain't ruling no more. You're a bloodthirsty man. He was basically accusing him of killing Saul. Because once again, he didn't have all the facts. We never have all the facts. But he was being faithful to Saul, and so he was, and then what is, and Joab, it was actually Joab in that story that says, hey, king, you want me to go kill him? He's like, what are you talking about, Joab? What? You ain't got no sense. The Spirit of the Lord is upon us, and you want to go kill somebody? Oh, my. Sorry, King. Sorry, Uncle. He says, no. The Lord sent him to come curse me. The Lord sent him to come do this to me. The Lord sent him to come see if I will be faithful. David said, I will be faithful. Somebody send somebody in your life to curse you and throw rocks at you, and spit on you and make fun of you and laugh at you? You want retaliation? Or will you be faithful? Will they die of gray hair? Or you pray they die an early death? I pray we change that prayer this week and say, Lord, I pray they die with gray hair. Amen. You protect them, just like Moses. You get on your knees, you get on your face, and you pray to God and say, Lord, protect them. Amen. Protect my family that has caused this pain. Protect my enemy that has caused this pain. Or you can cry Corbin and go kill him. And you follow traditions, and you're going down with them. You go down in flames just like they do. Or we can honor and hold on to the word of God and say, Lord, I can't rewrite this. I could spend a lifetime. I couldn't possibly even rewrite one verse that would say it and do it better than God would. It's impossible. That's why we cherish this and hold on to this, because there's truth in it. There's life in it. And we got to look past the traditions and the silliness. Verse 13, making the word of God none effect through your traditions, which ye have delivered, and many such things you do. We hold on to these things, and that's why the power of Christ in us is void. The word is void because we hold on to the traditions. They actually have more power in my life than the Bible itself, than the Spirit of Christ in me itself. The traditions do, which is why I pray God continue to destroy traditions day after day after day. And me too, because it's a lot of the traditions is usually up in here. You know, I'm holy if I at least read one chapter in the morning. If I don't make it through one chapter, then I'm not holy. But if I make it through the whole chapter in the morning, then I can start my day and I'm good. Am I the only one that's ever had that tradition? Because I used to read a few verses, and then I thought the Lord said, well, you got to read the whole chapter. Oh, okay. And then I read the whole chapter. But then I knew it was good for the day. And then, of course, you know, anybody have their prayer window? I had my prayer window. Lord have mercy. I had more holes in that prayer window than a screen fence. And it's okay, it's again, God chose it, but those traditions weren't saving me and they weren't saving anybody else. Oh man. Verse 15, there is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are they which defile the man. Nothing you say, do, can defile you. What defiles you? It's what comes out of you that defiles you. It's your thinking that comes out of you. And Hebrews even says that. What is the evil thoughts? The evil thoughts are unbelief, church. What makes me evil? When I don't believe God really loves me and that God really cares and that God doesn't find fault. Now I'm evil. I believe something other than what God believes. I am evil. We knew you were evil, Pastor. We just couldn't figure it out. It's unbelief. It's unbelief. It's not that what I say and do doesn't make us evil. What you say and do doesn't make you evil. It's the unbelief. It's the presuming to know better than God. It's presuming I am better than others. That's evil. Well, if they did this and I don't, then I am better. Yeah, you're evil. The minute you do that, you're evil. Right? Didn't even Jesus say that? Why do you worry about the splinter in your brother's eye? Worry about the log in your eye. You see, the offense, Jesus didn't see the offense as the issue. He called it a splinter. You say, yeah, but it was only a little issue. No, I say it was, let's just say it was murder. Somebody murdered somebody. He saw that as a splinter. What he saw as the greater offense is you calling it out. That was the log in the eye. It was you seeing it and calling it out. What does Proverbs say? Hatred stirs up strife. Love covers a multitude of sin. Not one sin, church. A multitude, more than you could possibly count. Will somebody cover it? Hatred will stir it up. You know how I stir it up? Psst, let me tell you what Mike did. I stir it up, stir it up. I get to stir it. I got a big old spoon. I'm splashing stuff all over the place. Love covers it, church. Jesus covered the world. He came to cover it. What did he cover with love, man? Love. Amen. He's not stirring it up. He ain't finding fault, man. Lord, have mercy. If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. If any man have ear, faith comes by hearing, church, hearing the word. And then the spirit that dwells inside of you that tells you and you know full well what is your Corbin versus what is God's word that dwells inside of you. Faith comes by hearing. Verse 20. And he said, that which come out of a man, that defileth the man. And again, what comes out of it's my words. What comes out of your mouth? Words. James says that. James, I believe chapter 3, he says that your tongue is a fire. It sets the world ablaze. It defiles the world with fire. What defiles the world with fire? My mouth, when I call out your sins. When I say, Ryan Lochte's no good, give me back the medals. You can't represent my country. I have now defiled the world. It came out of my mouth. Again, the heart. Jesus is after the heart, church. Not the actions. The actions don't cleanse the heart. The heart's already clean. When the heart is clean, my actions are then right. We got it backwards sometimes. Amen. Amen. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye. Oh my goodness, just one eye? Yep, it's the evil eye. It's the stink eye. It's the one that'll find your sin one way or another. I'll find it. Blasphemy, pride, and foolishness. Foolishness? God considers foolishness evil? No one has ever been foolish? Lord have mercy. And all these evil things that come from within that defile a man. And he lists out the 13 evil offenses. And I believe this is just, again, it's just when I don't have an understanding of who God is and the life he's called us to live. And so it's just, it's within. And so I recognize all of these things and everybody else but me. And really it's just a reflection of my heart. If I see it in you, it's only because it's reflected in my heart. If I say you are evil, it's only because I see evil in my heart. And I'm not recognizing the Christ in me, and so therefore I'm not recognizing the Christ in you. And really, the only way I do that is when I don't obey God's word. Interestingly enough, Ishmael was circumcised when he was 13 years old. Wow. Now, you were supposed to be circumcised on the eighth day, according to Jewish law, which is what? The eighth day, it's a new beginning. Circumcising the flesh for what? The heart. But Ishmael was 13. Now, if you remember the story with Ishmael, Abraham had a son. His first son was Ishmael. Isaac wasn't his first son. Ishmael was his first son. Problem was, he did what his wife told him to do instead of what God told him to do. Because Sarah said, it's been a long time. I guess I'm not going to have any kids. I really like one. Hey, why don't you go with my handmaid and let's have a kid. And it says, Abraham obeyed Sarah. He didn't obey God. There you go. There's your issue right there. She presumed, it's just the soul of man, Sarah. Sarah dwells inside of me. Oh, won't you smile a while for me, Sarah? Just the soul of man. When I listen to my soul instead of God, I create Ishmael. I create a disobedient lifestyle. I can obey, but I do something other than what God says. And so I create all these situations in my life. And until I realize that Isaac, the Isaac that's in us, the Christ that's in us, that will be birthed, it is spirit, it is spirit, it is spirit. And truly recognize the love of God in my life and in your life, I just don't see things the right way. I'm going to ask the worship team if they'll come. And actually, if we can, Brother Keith, can we do Free? The second song you guys did, Free? Is that, well, Freedom, whatever the title is? Since you guys rocked it so hard there, Brian, you know what I'm saying? Because we are free. We are free. We don't find fault. We don't see faults in others. We see the Christ in others. And then let go of Corbin. Listen, we all got Corbins. We all got them. I don't know what they are. I got them. And I say, Lord, when you find those in my life, please tell me and get rid of them. I don't want them. The only thing I want in my life is what's written in the Word of God. Because then I know I can't go wrong. I can't have Amalekites beating me up and Canaanites beating me up and all this stuff weighing me down. If I do what he says to do, then I know I live the right life. I know my life then becomes trouble-free. And I don't find fault in others. And I just find Christ and I just start living that life. So I say, Lord, get rid of that stuff. If I've got some silly idea in my head of what I think you want or expect and it's not you and it doesn't line up with your word, man, get it gone. Get it gone, Lord. That's between you and the Lord. Just pray that prayer. Like he's not going to show you. He will show you. I promise you, church. He will show you. You just got to be like Moses and get on your face and say, Lord, help me out here, man. And I believe he will. I believe he'll show that to you. And then you will become better, stronger, faster. Da-na-na-na. Come on, why don't you stand while we close out.
All right, Pastor Phil. Thank you. Thank you for that word. Amen. Sometimes you hear a word that refreshes you, and I just want to say thank you. And I don't say thank you often to my brother Philip, but... You know what the word of the Lord does for me? It wakes me up. It wakes me up. You know what religion and tradition does? It puts me to sleep. Anybody ever been put to sleep by religion? It's interesting. I was talking to my brother this morning. We were talking about, you know, going to church. We say, half the people fall asleep in church. Not our church. We're talking about just church in general. It's most of the people that get their Sunday naps during the message. But, you know, not today for sure. but the truth is this. Religion and tradition puts us to sleep. We are asleep going through the motions of what we think is God and life, and there's no life in it. And I hear the word of the Lord that's spoken today, and what it does, it just wakes me up, man. I become alive and refreshed again. It's like, yes, that is God. That's it. That's what I want. That's what I'm looking for. That's it. That's the word of the Lord. And then I say, well, what's my conclusion to it all? And as I sat there this morning, the conclusion is this. I just have peace. And I don't know if you experienced, but I'll tell you what I got today. Peace. I don't have to fight. I don't have to struggle. All this fault-finding and, my goodness, it produces such a strife. Religion produces strife and divisions, you know? But the word of the Lord, it wakes us up to life. It gives us peace and rest when we don't have to struggle to love God and struggle to serve him. And there's no struggle in it. So thank you for the word of the Lord. Amen. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your faithful servant and the faithful words that you have given him today. And our prayer is this. Let us continue to be wakened from our sleep. We pray, my Lord, that we would rise up from the dust of the earth, Almighty God. And let us be awake to live the life that you've given us to live, Lord Jesus, in freedom, Lord, for sure. So let your word abide, let it remain, let it produce the very kingdom of heaven. It's in the powerful name of Jesus, and everybody says, amen, amen. God bless you. Come back at 3:00, everybody. God bless you.